Bonsoir.
Bonsoir.
Oh, bon après-midi.
I was saying, you get yourself already the next couple hours.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Now, this is the part of the service where the children's service come up.
Woo!
And I'm going to tell you this now. They've been working hard. They've been ready. They've been excited for this. And I want to ask you guys to support them, to clap with them, sing with them,
Amen.
Encourage them, because you know they're the
yes.
young ones. They're going to be after all of us. It's them. So
yes.
please encourage them and clap with them.
Amen. Good afternoon, church. My name is Carm, and I will be the MC for the day.
Yes, sir.
And now I'll be calling Brother Jonas to come pray for us.
Amen.
Everyone, bow their heads, please. Father God, thank you for making this good day and blessing us and bless everyone that's here and keeping us safe. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. And now I'll be calling the children worship team to come sing a song by the grace of the Lord.
Amen.
Thank you.
Jesus says, nobody can say no.
Worship God through giving. The offering verse will be found on 2 Corinthians 9, verse 6 through 7. Remember this, whosoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and whosoever sows generously will also reap generously. Each of you shall give what you have decided in your heart to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. Amen.
Amen.
Now let us be cheerful givers.
I got the victor living in me.
the offering. Father God, we thank you for this wonderful offering you have allowed us to give to you. We ask that this offering be used for your ministry. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. We would like to take this moment to sing happy birthday to Elijah. Can you come to the front?
Yes, sir. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday. So many years in the name of Jesus, and God bless you.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So Elijah is 10 today. So I can tell you 10 is a decisive age because that's a double digit now. So he's gonna stay there all the way to 99 years and then he's gonna go to the three digits.
Amen.
So you may God bless you, you know, by crossing this great path in your lifetime, and we'll continue to pray for you. Now I can tell you, you see these the children that just performed. Wait to see Elijah.
Amen.
Wait to see him.
Amen.
So he's next.
Amen.
So let's pray for him. Let's continue to pray for him. Now we're gonna transition with the Lord's Supper service. It'll be me and Pastor Mark who will do it. So I'll say thank you.
Lower the
wireless ones. Lower the wireless. You're going to see that it's a wireless. Just over there. Amen. That's very good. So the Lord's Supper service. So how are you guys doing so far? I'm pretty sure you guys been uplifted this morning because it's been a very, very touching praise and worship service, and the children made it more uplifting. So we praise the Lord for that. So the worship service will be found in Matthew 26, verse 26 to 28. That's where Jesus gives us instructions, telling us why is it so important to partake in worship service. So we do it every often. There's some churches that do it every week or every time they gather, they do that communion. Some of the churches that do it quarterly, some of the churches that do it yearly. So regardless how often that you do it, the thing that's more important that you do it for the Lord. So Matthew 28, 26, 28, Jesus instituted the Lord's Supper. It says, as they were eating, Jesus took bread, blessed, and broke it, gave it to the disciples, and said, take it and eat it. This is my body. Then he took a cup, and after giving thanks, he gave it to them and said, drink from it, all of you. Drink from it, all of you. For this is my blood that establishes a covenant. It is shed for many
for the forgiveness of their sins.
Matthieu 26, verset 26 à 28, nous lisons, pendant qu'ils mangeaient, Jésus prit du pain, et après avoir rendu grâce, il le rompit et le donna aux disciples, en disant, prenez, mangez, ceci est mon corps. Il prit ensuite une coupe, et après avoir rendu grâce, il la leur donna en disant, buvez-en tous, car ceci est mon sang, le sang de l'Alliance, qui est répandu pour plusieurs, pour la rémission des péchés.
And also we read in 1 Corinthians 11, verse 23-28. 1 Corinthians 11, verse 23-28. For I receive from the Lord, Paul talking, that I also pass on to you. The Lord Jesus Christ, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, this is my body which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, this cup is a new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.
1 Corinthians 11, verses 23-28. 1 Corinthians 11, verses 23-28. Car j'ai reçu du Seigneur ce que je vous ai enseigné. C'est que le Seigneur Jésus, dans la nuit où il fut livré, prit du pain. Et après avoir rendu grâce, le rompit et dit, ceci est mon corps qui est rompu pour vous. Faites ceci en mémoire de moi. De même, après avoir soupé, il prit la coupe et dit, cette coupe est la nouvelle alliance en mon sang. Faites ceci en mémoire de moi toutes les fois que vous en boirez. Car toutes les fois que vous mangez ce pain et que vous buvez cette coupe, vous annoncez la mort du Seigneur jusqu'à ce qu'il vienne. C'est pourquoi celui qui mangera le pain ou boira la coupe du Seigneur indignement sera coupable envers le corps et le sang du Seigneur. Que chacun donc s'éprouve soi-même et qu'ainsi il mange du pain et boive de la coupe.
Amen. So, the supper is not for little children because they really cannot discern at this age. So when they can, they'll be able to assist or to participate in this service. And at the same time, the Lord's Supper is for people who have faith in Jesus Christ. After knowing or acknowledging or accepting that Jesus Christ died at the cross for their sins. But however, this, not all the time as Christians, we are in a situation to receive the Lord's Supper. So Paul always asks every single one of us to examine ourselves. Examining ourselves. And that's something that I will exhort you to do before taking this cup today. But as he just said at the beginning on in Matthew 28, 26, 26, 28, it is for every single one of us. You just have to dispose yourself, dispose your heart, and be ready to accept it, to receive it, and to partake as we pass the cup.
So you can start getting your cup ready by peeling those two tops to get to free the bread and then free the grape juice. Let us pray. God Almighty, I come to you in the name of Jesus Christ. I ask that you bless every single one of us who is partaking in this service, now and forever. I pray you in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. The Lord Jesus Christ, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." I'd like to remind you that the body of Jesus Christ became an offering for our sin. We have been sanctified through the offering of the body of Jesus Christ once and for all. Jesus said, "Do this in remembrance of me." Let us eat together.
What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus.
Supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." I would like to remind you that the juice represents Jesus' blood that was shed at the cross for all of us. Take and drink it in remembrance of Jesus Christ. Let us drink together. This cup today in your name, and for knowing that you have sacrificed yourself for our sins, that you died at the cross for our past, but we know that you resurrected, you have victory over death. That is good, that is great, that is what we celebrated today. We celebrate in your death and we celebrate in your resurrection. We thank you for allowing us. For those of us that did not have a chance to take the cup today, I ask that you go and touch every single heart. Because only you can change hearts. We as human, we can see, but only you change. And I ask that you change. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. I want to welcome every single one of you here today. It's always a great pleasure to see all of you in the body of Christ. I'm always happy to see you, and I'm always encouraged to be in this service with you. Today was a great service, a service to the Lord, a service uplifted not only by the worshipers, but by the children. The children, they have performed a wonderful service here today. I want to ask you to put that in your mind. As you come here today, you don't come here just because you want. You don't come here because you want to avoid something at home, or you want to stay away from a situation. You come here for a purpose. And I pray that God Almighty will let you see this purpose today. By the time you leave here today, God will allow you to have a relation with Him. For those of you who do not know Christ yet, God will touch you so that you can now have a relationship with Him. For those of us that already have a relationship with Jesus Christ, we ask that that relationship is deeper and deeper, because that's what we're here for, that's what we're longing for, that's what we're seeking, that's what we're knocking on Jesus Christ's door, so that we can have that deeper relationship with Him. So I will ask the church to continue to pray for everyone that you know that been touching this sanctuary. This church, when I say this church, whether it's these four walls or this church outside of these four walls, this community of love that you guys know, that people that been here in this church, wherever they are, I ask that you pray for them. We have about 7 families out there. And then we have about 8 single people out there that I ask you to pray for them. To pray for them so that the purpose that God planted in their heart, that they don't shift away from that purpose. Every time you come to this church, I will ask you to pray for them. It's so many of them. It's about 50 people altogether. Those 7 families and those 8 people. Just pray. Last night was a wonderful night because the children of this church, the people of this church, we participated in the El Paso Youth Rally, where a lot of young people of El Paso get together and then praise the Lord, praise God. And it was extremely uplifted. One of the part of the sermon is when the pastor, Pastor Zamora, he talks about Satan does not know our future. Satan does not know where you're going. Only God Almighty can see where we're going. And only God can shape the direction where we're going. The other thing that he said that very powerful is that Satan can use every single one of us. Satan can influence our body, ourselves. Satan can only do that, influence. Satan can put situations in our lives like Satan did in Job's life. But Satan cannot see where we're heading. Satan cannot predict our future. Therefore, Satan cannot touch our future. So we need to continue to let God use us. Let God be the God of our lives. Let God be the center piece of everything that we do. So today, many of you see that members get the logo of the church here. So I can tell you, and exactly about the children's service, we do that every last Sunday of the month. So the last Sunday of April, we're gonna do the same thing. as we did today. So I encourage every single one of us to encourage the children to be part of it. But I'm talking about the uniform, what I call the uniform, right? So because you got the logo of the church in there. So the last Sunday of the month, anyone can wear that community church logo or church uniform. Now, to help me talk about uniform, we do not have a policy. We don't have something in this church that's saying that this is the dress that you have to wear. This is how you have to conduct yourself. This is what you need to do. This is not what you need to do. If you hear people say that we have a church dress code, ask them. Ask these people. When did the pastor tell you that you have to wear certain clothes? When? So just ask them. So because we do not. You come here, you come as you are. What I see, the physical body that I see, that's not about me to talk about it. Because I don't know your spiritual, I don't know what inside you. I can see your body, however you are. It's between you and God. Like we talked about it last week, that we have to establish a spiritual relationship with the Lord. Once we establish that spiritual relationship, we're not gonna be worried about what people worry. But we worry about the spiritual growth. So, two things before I go to the sermon, and we only have 20 minutes. So I wanna thank Sister Kenisha, Sister Box, and Sister Lisa for working with these children of God, working with them to show them the way. What a wonderful performance. And you got children singing, you have children praying, you got a child of God delivering the sermon, you got Lara leading. So all this stuff, because you, the children, you are the feature of this church. As I dismiss these children today to Sister Lisa. And Sister Lisa, you can take that. And then next week, next Saturday is Johanna's birthday party at the house. So you guys can have more information, get with my wife. She'll tell you all about what we're gonna be doing. So the uniform, the logo, if any one of you wanna get the logo sewn on your clothes, you can get with me or get with First Lady. We will direct you to where we can have that done. So this week we're working in 1 Corinthians 2, and that's what we do Thursday. We finish the Bible study on 1 Corinthians 2. And then Thursday, Friday, Saturday, and today we're working on 1 Corinthians 3. If you were here this morning, you probably read heard the scripture reading by Brother Junior. It's a lot of stuff. Like Pastor Mark said this morning, in 1 Corinthians 3, every single verse is a subject of preaching. Every single verse of them. They got 21 verses. So, you know, we'll have to spend a lot of time really to cover the entire chapter 3. But today I will just focus on verse 1 through verse 5. Verse 1 through verse 5. Dear brothers and sisters, when I was with you, I could not talk to you as I would to spiritual people. I had to talk as though you belonged to this world, as though you were infants
in Christ. I had to feed you with milk, not with solid food, because you were not ready for anything stronger. And you still are not ready, for you are still controlled by your sinful nature. You are jealous of one another and quarrel with each other. Doesn't that prove you are controlled by your sinful nature? Aren't you living like people of the world? When one of you say, I'm following Paul, and another say, I'm following Apollos, aren't you acting just like people of the world? Verse 5, after all, who is Apollos? Who's Paul? We are only God's servants through whom you believe the good news. Each of us did the work the Lord gave us. As I pray, Lord Almighty, I pray, if I'm going to say one word today, I ask that that one word touch the heart of the people here today. And I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. So we've been working for a long time now, studying the epistles, the letters that Paul been written to many churches. So we finished last month with Romans. And now we transition with Corinthians. We're in 1 Corinthians now. And our intent is to, for us Christians to be better in the Lord. For us Christians that we understand that we are in this world, but we are not part of this world. We are to, because Jesus called us to be the light of this world. We cannot be the light of this world if we are the same as the people we try to reach out to. We have to distinct ourselves from that. So the theme that we've been going through since the beginning is that we need to surrender ourselves and put God first. And today, by the time I'm finishing talking to you, I will hope that I can express to you how we can put God first in our lives and surrender in ourselves. I can tell you, 1 Corinthians 3 is one of the texts that offering a tender hope and tough mind, warning in this very same truth. The hope is especially intended for the earnest struggles in the faith. And the warning is especially for those careless drifters. So I can tell you, Paul wrote this letter to the Corinthians, to the church that he helped build, because the church was shifting way, 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 way away from the prescription of the Bible, the prescription of God. The church became so bad that they were close to be the same as the society that they were living. Like I told you last week, the current, that city was a city filled with bad things. So what Paul has done, he's trying to reach out to those Christians to tell them in the direction that you're heading is a direction of fullness, a direction of destruction. You need to move yourself away from that direction and follow the direction of the Lord. And chapter 2 and chapter 3, it's really almost the same thing. And what Paul really is spoken about division. In chapter 3, we see divisions. In chapter
chapter 2, we saw Paul talking about division. And chapter 3, again, he's talking about division. Division because people let the focus go away. The focus is supposed to be at Jesus Christ. And he sees that the focus of the people, instead of being at Jesus Christ, who is the savior of this universe, but he sees that the focus of the people is about Apollos, is about Paul, is about Peter, is about whatever. Then the main focus is Jesus Christ. So why is that important? This is important because if we start leaving the focus of Jesus Christ or on Jesus Christ, and then we start seeing other things, we're not going to understand that Jesus, that God sent Jesus Christ to die at the cross for us. We're going to minimize the effect of the cross. But if we let the Holy Spirit work with us so that we don't see natural things, we see Jesus Christ ahead of us, so we'll be heading to the right path. So it is important that Paul address that specific issue, the issue about division. Now we see that issue is within churches today. We see that the Bible says that when the devil comes, the devil doesn't come to play. When the devil comes to steal, to kill, and to destroy. And who the devil gonna be using to do that? The devil gonna be using us to do that. Who the devil gonna be using to kill, steal, and destroy? The devil gonna use family members to do that. The devil gonna be using good friends to do that. The devil gonna be using colleagues, people that working at the same place with you, people that studying the same thing with you, people at whatever you may think. But don't look at the problem as the person is the problem, because the person is not the problem. Because the Bible talks about spiritual warfare. If I have a problem with my wife, I don't see my wife, the physical person that in front of me, as the problem. I see the devil is using my wife so that she can be discouraging me, or she can be doing anything. And it's the same thing. The devil can be using me to destroy my wife. So that you have to understand the warfare that's going on. You have to understand that. Now, Paul talk about, I cannot talk to you now in a spiritual way. I cannot talk to you in a spiritual way because you have not grown spiritual yet. This is not simple terms. This is a very strict, in these days, in this setting, we will say accusation. But Paul wasn't accusing. Paul was pointing a problem. So Paul said, I cannot talk to you about spiritual things. Because it's like, if I talk to you about spiritual things, then two things are going to happen. You're not going to understand what I'm talking about. Or you're going to spill that spiritual thing away. Like, you know, in the army, we have those secret levels, right? You have those top secret, you got confidential. This is something that the guy might be with you, but they're not gonna share it with you. Because you don't have that level of spirituality. No, you don't have that level of secret for you to know what I'm talking to you. No, it's the same thing that Paul talked about. Paul said, hey, I cannot talk to you the way that I'm supposed to be talking to you. Because you're not spiritually connected. And I talked to you last week in 2 Corinthians, the verse 3. Not verse 3, but verse 10, 11, 12, 13, where it spoke about you, we need to be spiritually connected so that when we talk to our Lord, we can know what he's talking about. So it's the same thing about the secret, right? Secret, top secret, whatever, those levels, right? If you do not have a clearance, if you do not have a secret clearance or top secret clearance, I cannot talk to you, right, as human. It's the same way if you do not have a spiritual level, God cannot talk to you. A lot of people have not heard their prayer being answered. You have to put yourself in a spiritual way so that your prayer will be able to be heard, and then you'll be able to communicate. You'll be able to have a dialogue with the Lord. The sister talking about being in a dark room so that she can communicate with the Lord. Oh God Almighty, what a powerful statement. What a powerful thing to do. Somebody talk about why we have to close our eyes when we pray. Because there's so much distraction in front of us. You have to close your eyes so that you can have that moment with the Lord. But sometimes you close your eyes, but you still do not have that connection. For example, if my problem is a mental problem, right? So as I pray, the mental problem is right here in front of me. I put the mental problem as the problem of my life. And I'm supposed to be talking to God. So if the problem that you're going through right now, if you put the problem right here in front of you, what do you think is happening? You're not seeing God, because God is here with us. But when you see, God is far away. But if you block in your sight with something, you're not gonna be able to see God. So therefore, don't put your problems. Do not put your problems in front of you as you try to communicate with God. You have to be able to distinct yourselves from these problems. Jesus already tells us that we are going to face problems, trials and tribulations. We are going to be tested by the devil. We are going to be tested by the Lord also. God is testing our character. God is testing to see how far we can go. It's the same thing we talk about secret and non-secret. How far, if I give you this, how far are you going to carry it without dropping it? God is looking at the same way. So Paul is talking about giving milk. Now you know Paul talking to Christians. Paul is not talking to anybody here but Christians. He's talking about, I cannot feed you solid food. I have to give you milk. Now, you know, I can talk to you about children, right? Because I have eight. I've seen eight growing up from birth all the way to their ages right now. So the babies, what happened is they just want more. Or if they don't get what they want, they just cry. Babies, they don't have that ability, the mental set mind to do more. It's where they are. But now, when Paul compare Christians with babies, this is not something simple. This is something that we have to look at. Are we gonna be a 50-year-old or 60-year-old or 70-year-old that's still in Christianity feeding by milk? Are we not putting ourselves in a situation where we can now get in those, you know, hard, those solid food? And I can tell you, so milk, you know, we talk about spirituality and naturality, right? Spirituality is like